Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the program coordinator for NCWIT Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the third episode of this six-part series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month through July, we'll be connecting you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS+X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women in computing existed mostly in isolation, and without the benefit of shared practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are a part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing, or C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. The NCWIT Counselors for Computing program offers information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. We wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, and scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. And we've shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. I would now love to introduce our guest speakers today, Kevin Nolten and Samina Mondal. Hi, Kevin and Samina. Kevin serves as the Director of Academic Outreach for the Cyber Innovation Center with 16 years of management experience, including six in the K-12 education. Kevin oversees operations of cyber.org, an organization funded by federal grant to develop cybersecurity curricula, professional development, and other resources for K-12 educators, school districts, and state departments of education across the country. Kevin's visionary passion and philosophy has led to the expansion of the Cyber Innovation Center's workforce programs to communities across the county, all with the goal of developing the next generation of cyber literate workforce. And Samina Mondal is a second year at the University of Virginia, interested in pursuing media studies. She currently serves as a public affairs intern for the US Naval Research Laboratory, working directly with media, government relations, and STEM outreach. Samina is extremely passionate about providing K-12 students cybersecurity education through her initiative, cyberweek.org. Through her team's work, they teach students a series of curriculums on how to detect online threats, gain a better understanding of how the internet works, and spark an interest in the DoD STEM careers of the future. So thank you, Kevin and Samina. And attendees, please enjoy this presentation on cybersecurity careers and their educational pathways. Again, we would love for you to ask questions through the presentation using the Q&A feature at the bottom of the Zoom toolbar. We'll answer them either in the Q&A feature or through the live Q&A at the end of the presentation. Thanks, Kevin and Samina.
Hello and greetings to this webinar. We are so excited for everyone to be joining us today. We have an incredible conversation that is teed up around the cybersecurity workforce. My name is Kevin Nolten. I'm the Director of Academic Outreach for cyber.org, and I'm joined by a friend named Samina Mondal, who is the founder of cyberweek.org. And together, we hope to have just a great and incredible conversation around cybersecurity education and how critical cybersecurity education is to solving the nation's cyber workforce challenge. We know today, and I'm sure everyone on this this webinar knows that the cybersecurity workforce has a tremendous gap. They have a tremendous gap in that there are over 500,000 job openings today, and we don't have a workforce to fill it. And that number is only going to exponentially grow, 1.7 million by the end of next year, by 2022. Those are eye-opening numbers. And we could talk about some of the economic challenges, but I see this as really a national security challenge too, because cybersecurity is not just the government's problem. Cybersecurity is not just industry's problem. Cybersecurity is everyone's problem. Cybersecurity is an opportunity for us and a responsibility of us to ensure that we are protecting our infrastructure, protecting our assets, and protecting our businesses growing into the future. Many say that, you know, cybersecurity, oh, that's just for the technology folks or people who are interested in computers or people who want to be computer scientists. Well, I'm here to tell you, and I think Samina will agree with me, is that cybersecurity has implications across all academic disciplines. It has implications across all industries. Whether you're going to be a doctor, a lawyer, a vet, or you're going to own the flower shop on the corner of 3rd and Main Street, cybersecurity plays a critical role. So what our jobs are, both as educators and community leaders, is to ensure that we are investing in the future of our students, that we are investing in the knowledge base that will become our workforce of the future. I just got back from a trip that we went hiking in the woods, and we did it as a family. And we got to see these just giant, enormous trees that provided such beautiful shade, that provided such an amazing and beautiful ecosystem of birds and worms and, you know, all of these animals. And you think about that forest was not just put there yesterday for me to enjoy. That forest was the result of hard work, dedication, and planning of generations past, of decades and even centuries ago. So what our opportunities and jobs as educators is to start planting seeds today so that we can then enjoy this beautiful forest tomorrow for generations and decades ahead. What we have to do is ensure that our workforce is cyber literate. And so some of the things that I hope to share with you all today, and Samina as well, is some of the resources that we have to provide you as educators so that we can begin chipping away at this monumental challenge. You know, when I was in the classroom, I'd always say to my students, what do you want to be when you grow up? Or what problems do you want to solve when you grow up? And my students would always answer, you know, oh, I want to be a vet. I want to be a doctor. I want to be a lawyer. But one student raised his hand and said, Mr. Nolten, how can you expect me to tell you what I want to be when I grow up when I don't know what all the options are? That was the aha moment for me as an educator to say, I need to introduce my students to opportunities of tomorrow. I need to introduce my students to careers that they may not have any idea about. And when we talk about cybersecurity, that is a big unknown to many parents, to many teachers, to many mentors. And so we hope to raise the awareness. So starting off, I would love Samina to talk about what her organization is doing from the standpoint of ensuring that our educators have resources make up all kinds of platforms, the resources to begin introducing these students to these jobs. So Samina, I'd love for you to enlighten our audience on what you guys do and the amazing impact that you're having.
Sure. Thank you so much for the great introduction, Kevin. I'm going to go ahead and share my slides. So thank you all for the amazing opportunity to speak to you today about my organization, cyberweek.org. It's really an amazing opportunity to be able to work alongside Kevin for this program, for you all to learn about how to become greater technology advocates for your students with DoD STEM and NCLIT. It's really been a part of my journey ever since I was a second year in high school and as now a second year in college. NCWIT has really been a part of my journey and been with me through it all. I currently serve as a public affairs intern for the U.S. Naval Research Laboratory, which is actually a DOD laboratory in Washington, D.C. In addition, I'm a second year at the University of Virginia studying media studies with policy and ethics as my concentration. I'm very excited to speak to you all today about my experience with DOD STEM, how to get your students involved, and the story of how I've used my current DOD experience to create my program, cyberweek.org, a cybersecurity education framework for K-12 students. I hope that by the end of this presentation, counselors will get a better idea as to how to integrate programming and resources about computing careers and cybersecurity education to bring to your classrooms and really allow for the conversation behind cyber to become a reality in schools across the country. So a question that might be on your mind is, what exactly is DoD STEM? Now, having the experience working as an intern with the DoD for the past 2 years, I recognize that DoD, and specifically DoD STEM, is really an organization that truly represents strength through innovation. At DoD STEM, there are student opportunities that explore the foundations and fundamentals of various STEM disciplines, including computer science, geospatial sciences, and biology, just to name a few. Through my involvement with STEM outreach at the U.S. Naval Research Laboratory, I have met countless students seeking internships and apprenticeship opportunities while in high school, but don't exactly know where to find them. At DoD STEM, there are opportunities that range from internships to apprenticeships to scholarships that students can use in their college and graduate years. So it really is a plethora of opportunities that starts with K-12 and goes on into their post-grad. It's really a great feeling as a communicator and a public affairs person myself to be able to facilitate that introduction and overall communication between DoD STEM and educators and schools and students to really find what they're looking for. A lot of students want to have opportunities over the summer that they can take part in to explore a STEM discipline that they're familiar with, or maybe even one that they're not so familiar with. And that's really what I've recognized while being a founder of cyberweek.org. Security. They've heard the phrase before, they've heard about how it's, you know, up and coming, and it's in a part of many of the jobs that we have today, but they don't know how they can actually learn about cyber or get hands-on opportunities. So while I work in the DC area, I do cover different states of Maryland, Virginia, and the territory of DC, of course. And I've actually had such great opportunities working with counselors who are really the backbone of our program. They've helped me understand how to integrate DoD STEM curriculum as well as career development opportunities into the classroom in simple ways. So for example, in the state of Maryland over the past 2 years, we've been able to work with two amazing counties, Prince George's County and Frederick County, through school-sponsored events. So with the cybersecurity curriculum that I'm gonna talk to you guys a little bit about in the next slides, we were actually able to set aside a concrete week working alongside counselors, CTE professionals, and teachers to get students interested in various cybersecurity topics, ranging from binary to password protection and phishing, all the way to having DoD STEM career development panels where students learn more about how to integrate computer science and cybersecurity into their futures, and also how diverse the field is. I think that really the driving force of all of our efforts came from the teachers, the educators, the counselors, and how they were able to encourage students to take part in our week. They were able to make their vision of what they wanted a cybersecurity education week to be a reality. And that's honestly what I currently depend on when it comes to creating new opportunities for students on the monthly basis that we do at my organization. So that might leave a few questions on your mind as to where can I actually find these DoD STEM opportunities? Well, luckily, the DoD STEM website is a great way to start. It is divided based on the STEM programs that they have, ranging from K to graduate level. And depending on if your students are interested in a specific cybersecurity topic, or maybe even a specific topic related to a different STEM field, you can even divide the search that you have on the branch of service within the military that you're interested in taking part in. So it's really a great way to understand the diversity of programs in your area, but also a great way to get in touch with different individuals that run programs. So a lot of the times you'll see program sites and the leaders within the community that are spearheading, which a lot of the times can be universities or as we have seen through my experience, DoD laboratories, and they want to hear from teachers and students as to how they can take part in certain programs and how they can apply and take part in a summer internship or maybe even an apprenticeship during the school year. There's really a lot that communicating with DoD STEM can offer students and teachers. Another thing that I would love to express to you all is the importance of getting in touch with local laboratories. From my experience working in Naval Laboratory, they want to hear from teachers and counselors and students as to how they can help out. There are so many researchers working on amazing projects each and every year, and they want to have students to be in that space with them, taking on different roles, understanding how basic functions of maybe computer science or engineering or physics can come together and make a career. So there are a lot of ways for students to take part, but it's really that initial communication that needs to happen. So I would highly recommend you all get in touch with local laboratories and program locations to see if there's any science or researchers that are trying to lead programs on their own, or maybe even one that they have in their place of work that they'd like to share with you. You really never know who's going to be able to lead you to the next path for your students. So I think it's definitely an amazing investment to make. So now I would like to share with you a little bit more about how I've transformed my journey with NCWIT and DoD STEM to create my organization, cyberweek.org. So I was able to build Cyberweek off of an idea that I had actually through NCWIT's Aspire IT program. And it's essentially a flexible week-long curriculum geared towards K-12 students to detect online threats, gain a better understanding of how the internet works, and to spark an interest in cybersecurity careers of the future. The ultimate goal behind Cyberweek programs that I host are to teach students how to be safe and conscious consumers, creators, and citizens 5 days at a time, stopping threats before they can happen. So while in college, I wanted to find a way to continue sharing my love of cybersecurity and cybersecurity awareness and education within my community, starting with the classrooms. And luckily, through NCWIT and DoD STEM support, I was allowed to do just that. So as a student leader with NCWIT's Aspire IT program, which is designed to teach K-12 girls programming fundamentals and computational thinking in a fun, creative way, I was able to bring my cybersecurity education organization to life. It actually started with me heading back to my third grade classroom, a bit of a 10-year reunion between my teacher and I, where I remember having my first memories of using a computer and technology at school. So I essentially brought along this idea of a week-long curriculum where students will learn more about cybersecurity awareness through various topics, beginner topics like password protection, phishing, understanding cyberbullying, and cyber policy in the classroom. These were 8 and 9 year olds that I was working with, and I was absolutely amazed as to how interested they were in furthering their knowledge of cybersecurity. They had gotten and grasped the topics instantly and were interested in learning more as to how cybersecurity could be a part of their classrooms. Not only were they understanding the fundamentals of really keeping up with cyber hygiene, but they were making connections to their everyday life and things that they've seen their parents encounter when it comes to cyber safety. I really got an idea at that point after having this alpha pilot program at the elementary school that students are the ultimate consumers of the internet. I think it's interesting to see, especially during this pandemic, how students rely on technology for their school, for entertainment, for basic communication. And it's really powerful to understand how exactly we can bring cybersecurity to make sure that they're safe at an early age and continue their cyber and media literacy as they continue on into their greater grades, as well as when they take on careers in the future. So with this idea in mind, I wanted to continue building Cyber Week after the Alpha pilot. And I was excited to see how maybe if we expanded the program to older students, how the reaction would change and maybe even benefit students to understand a little bit more about how cybersecurity could be a part of their future college career or career otherwise. So working with DoD STEM as an intern, I was able to host a program for students based off a curriculum that I wrote alongside my NCOA team, focused on social engineering, password protection, cyber policy and binary, as well as a unique new topic, DoD STEM exploration. So I actually reached out to the STEM coordinator at Oxon Hill High School, which was a school legitimately only 15 minutes away from the Naval Research Laboratory. It was interesting to see how that connection had never been made between the two, the school as well as the laboratory. But once we got into contact, we had an amazing time planning a week's worth of curriculum for 9 to 12 grade students. We saw that they were interested in learning a lot about how cybersecurity could be applied to their everyday life, as well as their future careers. So through the various resources that I've had with DoD STEM researchers and individuals that I've encountered at the laboratory, I was able to create a career development Q&A panel for students to take part in. It was live, and it is really amazing to see how a diverse lineup of researchers and scientists, some from unconventional backgrounds and some from ones that focused on different fields, like as we've discussed and Kevin had mentioned in the introduction, law and the humanities, and how they all were able to express their love of cybersecurity and computing even after taking on certain roles that may be considered a different or unconventional pathway. It was also wonderful to see the diverse voices that we were able to have at the panel. It was people from underrepresented communities that were able to really understand how to use DoD STEM's resources and opportunities to take on new roles in their career. So whether that be taking on a scholarship in college or even a fellowship post-college, we were able to get new ideas for students as to the many career paths that would be offered to them. It was really interesting to see how they were so excited to ask questions and were wondering what was the difference between computer engineering and mechanical engineering. They were able to get all of their questions answered through this career panel, and it was really interesting to see how simply just a panel was able to spark so much curiosity in them. I think ultimately one of the things that I recognize, and it was one of the greatest takeaways I had comparing the programs from the elementary school level and the high school level, was that we have different pathways of reaching students. And ultimately, it's with the same goal to further their curiosity and for them to ask questions as to what cybersecurity is and how exactly they can make that a reality in their future. So as of 2021, Cyber Week has hosted 5 programs, 2 of them being in person and 3 of them being virtual, for K-12 students with over 350 students served in the process. It's interesting because we usually conduct pre-surveys and post-surveys during our program to get a better idea of what students know about cybersecurity, what they want to know, and how we can do a better job in our future programming. It was amazing to see that about 97% of all students who participated in our programs said they are now interested in pursuing a career in cyber, as well as learning more about the Department of Defense. And it's really incredible to see how many students you can reach through a single program, and we're very excited to be expanding this year virtually. I really think it's all about the connections that we've had with schools and counselors and their support to make this week a reality. Really was what allowed it to be such a great program. I think it's a simple change that we make in the way that we approach cybersecurity programming and career exploration that can make all the difference. So right here on screen, I actually have an example of how to integrate cyberweek.org's framework into your classroom. So it can be as simple as having topics like password protection and how to get involved in DoD STEM as lessons in the classroom, as well as setting aside specific days for career development Q&As to allow students to get familiar with different scholarships that are available to them, or maybe even different professionals in the field they're interested in. Being able to identify faces and talk to individuals about their story is truly inspirational, and I know it's something that I would have loved to have had in high school. And some of the times when we work with schools specifically, we understand that a week-long curriculum can be a lot. And teachers are extremely busy, they have a lot on their plate. So it's very important to understand how we can tailor our resources to help you. So whether that be taking 2 days out of the week to have career development Q&As, or maybe having a 3-day lesson plan that we have focusing on cybersecurity principles, it's really all up to the teachers, the schools, the counselors to make that decision as to what the students want to see and how we can best support them in any way possible. Here's a little bit of a lesson breakdown of how we've kind of been doing our work for the past couple months. We see the need for cyberbullying and online healthy habits in elementary schools. And we start with basic topics of cybersecurity at that level. So utilizing PPTs and online discussions to kind of get students interested and familiar with cybersecurity at the elementary school age. Now, what I will say is it's interesting to see. Sometimes the middle school students are a little more advanced when it comes to cyber than the high school students. So it really just depends on your school and your students' familiarity with cybersecurity. But here's a little bit of a lesson breakdown as to how you can maybe integrate some major cybersecurity topics into your classrooms. That can be through various discussions, activities, or even career development days that you have with your students. Now, if you are looking for a way to bring cybersecurity into your classrooms in 2021, my Cyber Week team and I have been working to compile a developing curriculum website. And there you can explore lesson plans, PowerPoints, and various educational resources to be used in the classroom that really touch on the fundamentals of cybersecurity and provide an excellent introduction to students at the K-12 level. So we've divided up our programs based on elementary to high school, and we constantly update our resources based on different lesson plans that we're working on, different individuals we encounter, and have been working with various universities in the DC area to really amp up our lesson plans as well as the message we're trying to send to students. So you do not have to be from the DC area to host a Cyber Week. We are actually actively looking for ways to expand our programming in classrooms throughout the country. And we'd really love to hear from you. And if you're interested in integrating a lesson or a full week's worth of curriculum into your classroom, it's really all up to you. And it's very much so tailored towards students and teachers and being able to understand how we can work with them. I think that it's a great opportunity for you all to get a sense of how to integrate cybersecurity in the classroom. And we would be more than happy to provide any educational resources or DoD guest speakers, or maybe even career development info to support a event that you may have. We actually have 2 upcoming programs this summer, so please feel free to send me an email and let me know what you guys are interested in so we can get your students on board. With that being said, I'd like to leave you all with a few Cyber Week takeaways that I've had and really some of the thoughts that I've kind of compiled throughout my 2-year journey of starting cyberweek.org. DoD STEM, hands down, has allowed me to give back to the community and has shaped me into the person I am today with the countless opportunities it's offered me as an individual. And I want to find ways to allow students to see the organization the same way I do, that you can take advantage of internships and apprenticeships and scholarships while in high school and college and graduate level. And they're really there to support you each step of the way. 2 of the greatest takeaways I've recognized on my journey is that 1, counselors can take an active role in program production. So it really comes down to asking ourselves, what are we doing today to further students' knowledge of cybersecurity career exploration in the classroom? How can we do a better job at making it simple, making it something that teachers can support and something that's interesting to students to take part in and take an active role in being a listener during the program? And this can all be done internally. Through the counselors that I've worked with, they have done an amazing job at setting up weeks and maybe even classrooms to host our program in. And they've just been an absolute blessing to really all of the programs that we were able to establish over the last 2 years. I think it's about the initiative that we take as DoD STEM or as educators to be able to find ways to collaborate. So that comes into my second point. Communication with DoD facilities is key. Counselors have an idea as to how they want to shape programs, and they work with teachers and different educators in their classroom to make it a reality. So really, it's about integrating your community and finding different resources that advocate for your students. DoD STEM and Cyber Week are just one example of what you can use, and it really allows you to get a sense of how cybersecurity should be a part of your students' classroom and how it shouldn't be such a struggle to find opportunities. And this can be all done externally. So there's two ways to kind of find your role as a counselor and seeing what you want to add in the classroom, as well as how there's different DoD facilities to help you along the way. So I highly encourage you all to advocate for more DoD opportunities for students and to welcome guest speakers into your classroom, and maybe even try something new that you never thought of before to advocate for cybersecurity education. So I just want to say a huge thank you to everyone who was able to make it out to this webinar today. If you have any questions on DoD programs or Cyber Week, please go ahead and contact me at my email down below. I want to give a huge shout out to everyone at NCWIT C4C for having me today. And I'm going to go ahead and pass the mic off to the amazing Kevin from cyber.org.
Awesome. It would help if I unmute my microphone. Awesome, Samina. That was a really great overview of what you guys are doing in the space. And there's some really exciting things. You know, in the I want to remind folks who are listening to drop your questions in the chat. We are here ready to answer your questions, whether that's for Samina or myself. We're definitely happy to jump in and answer those questions. But we're also going to be doing a live Q&A after our presentation, and we'll be sticking around for questions there. So if you have a question, drop us in the chat. If we don't get to it by typing, we'll get to it during the live Q&A. But I wanted to piggyback a little bit on what Samina is doing with our time remaining and talk a little bit about the resources that cyber.org has to offer. Now, everything that I'm going to talk about here is available to educators at no cost, because we're actually funded through a federal grant from the U.S. Department of Homeland Security and the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency. And our goal ultimately is to ensure that we're providing educators with resources to be able to introduce students to cybersecurity, to introduce them to the very concepts and fundamentals of cybersecurity. So what you see on your screen here is a listing of our content and curriculum. What you're seeing here is what we provide at the elementary, middle, high school space, and ultimately the industry-based certifications that culminate in some of our content curriculum. And so many of you, like, you know, Samina was talking about, are wondering, okay, how in the world do I do cybersecurity at the elementary level? And what we do is introduce the very concepts that Samina mentioned, like importance of passwords, digital hygiene. But what we're doing is we're intertwining that into the science curriculum. So you need to teach series circuits and parallel circuits, or you need to teach, you know, mathematics, 5 - 3 = 2. We do it in a way that creates an engaging context to cybersecurity. So instead of having, you know, Sally has 3 apples at the house, she has 5 friends coming over, how many apples does Sally need to go out and buy? What we do is we change apples to gigabytes. And so we introduce students to the terminology around computers and technology. And then we say that, you know, your computer memory is like your mind. And so if I'm inundating Samina with 5 - 3 = 2, clouds are gray, sky is blue, grass is green, dogs bark, and one of Samina's friends asks her a real technical physics question, it's going to be hard for us to really to process that. So that's like a computer memory, where if we do a DDoS attack and we just inundate a computer with so much information, that computer can't handle normal, ordinary processes that we ask and we command it to do as the end user. So this is how we're taking science, integrating cybersecurity into it at the elementary, middle school level, and then jumping into a little bit more of the technical components at the end of their K-12 career, specifically with regards to their high school career. Now, one thing that we really focus on and that we really consider as an important component to this education is ensuring that we're connecting the dots to careers. So we have developed some career education resources for educators. And if you go to our website, you see, you see career exploration as one of the options on the menu screen. And so what I encourage everyone to do is to go into this and explore our career profile cards. Go in and take a look at the NICE Cybersecurity Workforce Framework Resource Center. Go to the interactive NICS career resource and career and studies guide on there. And these are just some incredible resources that you can browse and see. So I'm just going to click browse career profile cards. And what we have here are a number of different career profile cards that, you know, require degrees, do not require degrees. And so when you click them, you get to see all the different resources, all the different job requirements. You get to see the average salary of this position. You can download a card, download the poster. And then in some cases, you have career profile cards that have videos. And so you get to see you know, what a day in the life of this individual looks like. So this right here, you know, if I just advance it, we get to talk about how this individual is working through his job, how he got to that job. You know, again, another incredible resource that allows teachers and students to raise their awareness around what these careers look like. One of the things that I encourage you all to do and to look at, obviously, go onto our website and take a look at our content curriculum. This content curriculum is available at no cost to you. We also have professional development opportunities for educators as well. So to get an account, all you have to do is simply click sign up on cyber.org to browse professional development. You click the professional development tab. It talks about all the different workshops and our philosophies that we have. You can browse upcoming events. So capture the flag competitions. We have technical cybersecurity workshops. We've got a webinar coming up that later this week. And the page, the list goes on and on and on and on. And we're constantly updating this list. And I'll drop the list, this link in the chat for you all. But ultimately, when I'm walking away from this webinar and Samina and I really honestly just met to do this webinar, I'm really excited to see what resources she has and ways that they can support our educators. We've got over 22,000 teachers in our network and across all 50 states, 4 U.S. territories. And this work that we do in partnership with the work that cyberweek.org does and in partnership with NCWIT and Counselors for Computing, we all are marching towards the end goal, which is to close the gap in our cybersecurity workforce, to ensure that we are introducing students, as I mentioned earlier, and dropping and planting those seeds of opportunity at an early age so they can then begin going after and pursuing these cybersecurity degrees. We actually did a study a year and a half ago. We wanted to see where our students go right after high school. And so we did a pilot study and we saw that students who come from high schools who are teaching cyber.org's content curriculum are more likely to go pursue a cyber-based degree program or certification program. And I'll say that in other ways. High schools who are teaching cyber.org's content curriculum are sending 4 times as many students into a cyber-based degree program. Universities across the country are just clamoring for resources like Samina's, like ours, who introduce students to these career opportunities and degree opportunities at an early age so that they can then begin jumping into the deep end when they get into those degree programs. So in conclusion, I want to wrap up, you know, as on behalf of cyber.org and Samina and cyberweek.org, we are so excited and so thankful for the opportunity to present to everyone here. And we are going to push stop on the record button on this session and jump over to the live Q&A. So if you have questions, type them in the chat right now, or we'll see you in a few minutes to answer questions. Again, thank you for spending the time with us, and we'll see you on the other side of the Zoom link, and we'll answer some of your questions.
Right. Thank you so much, Kevin and Samina. That was a wonderful presentation. To get to some of the questions, I think the first one that we talked that we said we'd respond to live was about cybersecurity being fear-based and scary. So how do you kind of steer away from that when you're talking to younger students and then engaging further the older students?
Well, I think the first thing that we can talk about is just from a contextual standpoint, just like I use changing apples to gigabytes, that's an important skill that, you know, we're informing. You know, we also have an activity in our one of our curricula that teaches sound waves and frequencies. So we're having students build a harp out of a Frisbee and fishing line. They have to play a series of notes and unlocks a safe that contains encrypted documents. And so we learn about encryption and decryption. These are just great ways to not only say, oh my gosh, the sky is falling, but it's a way to introduce students to these concepts in a fun, engaging way. Our students have just curiosity runs abound in our students. And so we want to harness that curiosity and allow them to explore with the lessons that they already need to teach inside the classroom.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think a great point that you made, Kevin, was that students are inherently really curious. They want to be able to learn more and find different ways to explore cyber. And speaking from my experience working with elementary school students, one of the things I noticed is that they absolutely love being able to have those activities. I remember when we were teaching about a lesson about hacking and decoding, we had them have a little page in which they decoded some symbols to spell out a message to each other. Or even when we learned about phishing, we had them write phishing messages to one another on pieces of paper. It's interesting to see how creative we can be as educators and counselors and different individuals in the cyberspace to be able to provide those opportunities to younger students. So I think a lot of the fear base that comes out of cybersecurity can be eradicated through understanding that cyber is a part of our everyday life. It's learning about cyberbullying and cyber policy right in the classroom as they often do each and every year.
Yeah. I think I actually did an activity with a Pringles can, and yeah, the Pringles can was the decryptor. Is that a cyber.org lesson?
Yeah, that's a cyber.org lesson. So we have an Enigma lesson where we teach students about the Enigma. This is an awesome lesson for, you know, your history classes and your social studies classes, because we talk about the German Enigma and how it works. And we actually get students to build one. So you get a piece of, you know, can of Pringles, and you put a piece of paper around it, and there's an encoder ring, decoder ring. So it's really a fun way to engage students and teach them what encryption and decryption is.
Oh, that is a wonderful way to explain integrating that cybersecurity into your regular lessons, like you just said, with history and things. That is a wonderful way. And I just want to say this again, that both of your programs and resources are free for educators. So cyber.org's curriculum and cyberweek.org's resources and engaging activities. If either of you want to say a little bit more about all of the free things that you have on your websites.
Yeah, and they're available at no cost, right? Everything we do from a curriculum to professional development is available at no cost. And what I want to drive, the point that I want to drive home is, between both of our organizations, there are 1,000 ways to implement lessons on cybersecurity, whether you have 10 minutes inside of a class or whether you have a whole year worth of time. You have resources at your fingertips. And you know, what it amounts to is that how you want to do it. It's how you want to do it. And so the fact that it's free, which is, you know, as an educator, former classroom teacher, former assistant principal, free was my favorite four-letter F word, you know, that's what we can provide to you from a curriculum and PD, as well as technology and resources standpoint.
Definitely. And I think as we're currently trying to develop resources and curriculum elements that we're trying to get together, Cyber Week is definitely leaning towards creating those resources that are teacher facing. So thinking about using platforms like Google Slides, Google Docs, Google Sites, we really want it to be accessible, to be easy and completely free, just as everything that we do here, Kevin and I, it's really based on thinking about the teachers and really working in their best interest, making it something that can be a part of daily lessons like social studies or math or computer science. It really just takes having that curriculum, having these individuals that you can reach out to, and that's really what our organizations are all about.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to point all of our attendees to the chat. We have shared every possible resource that we could think of in there. We'd love for you to copy and paste some of those websites so that way you're able to access all of the resources that Kevin and Samina are talking about. As we are kind of talking about how accessible these things are, what about, is there anything else that you'd want to expand on with cyber.org or DoD STEM or even Cyber Week about how you're trying to reach communities that maybe might not always have access to all of this information or may not even be distributing it at this time?
Samina, you want to take a stab at that first?
Sure. So being from the DC area, a lot of the schools that we work with do have underserved communities and underrepresented students in STEM in general. So when approaching cyberweek.org, I always wanted to be able to provide free resources for all students for them to be able to access, but to also ensure that we work with schools that maybe even have some sort of program instilled that they're going to be able to have a netbook or some form of internet to take part in our programs, that it shouldn't be an issue for them to have to go out and get another computer just to join our programs. So it really comes down to, I think, finding out how the teachers and the schools operate in terms of their use of technology, ensuring that all the students have access to at least a microphone and a camera and a netbook that they're going to be able to use, and that we do focus on the importance of diversity in a lot of our programs. So we want to be able to show off that, hey, regardless of who you are or where you come from or what kind of socioeconomic background you may be considered, it's important to see that there are individuals that are able to take advantage of the DoD STEM opportunities, regardless of where they are, who they are. There are so many opportunities in cyber for them to learn more about, learn how to be supported by the programs, as well as by taking part in events like Kevin mine for the different cybersecurity topics that we teach. It's important to have those online resources and in-person resources that are accessible via websites or maybe even via email.
Thank you, Samina.
Yeah, that's an incredible strategy. And you know, one of the approaches that cyber.org takes is a targeted approach. We want to ensure that, you know, we're going into communities. However, we also take an approach that is very unique in that we focus at the elementary and middle school level of going into the science classrooms. Every student has to take science. So if we can go into the classroom where all students are having to go through, we then, you know, get to an opportunity that we focus on, or we get the result that we are focusing on, the diversity makeup of that school or that community. However, I want to touch on some of the targeted things that we are doing. We actually have a grant from the National Security Agency to develop an HBCU feeder program. So we are working with historically Black colleges and universities from across the country and working with their high schools to stand up feeder programs that will introduce students to cyber-based careers and cyber-based degree programs. Then they would then be informed of what the next steps are. We're also working with different Title I organizations, so focusing on underserved and underrepresented populations. We've seen tremendous impact in the rural communities because our content is both plugged and unplugged. And it's so important that we focus on the unplugged aspect, because I realized the landscape of K-12 schools today. So being able to provide these unplugged resources that teaches cybersecurity to these students is an absolutely critical component for what cyber.org does. And listen, I was in a very, very small, very, very poor K-8 school, and I was rubbing nickels together all the time to try to provide resources for my students. And so things like this, where I come from, it's important to be able to kind of sweat those tears out and understand the challenges that educators face in those underperforming schools.
Thank you. I think that I know myself, and I'm sure the attendees, educators are going to really appreciate those direct strategies that you've offered here for getting students engaged, and the things that cyber.org and the things that you're doing, Samina, amazing, and I'm extremely helpful for our students. So Kevin, you were just talking about those, the careers and the educational pathways towards those. And Samina, I know you're a second year in school, but talk to me a little bit about even some other educational pathways outside of going to your standard four-year college.
Yeah, one of the things that I love to talk about is building a cyber interstate with multiple on-ramps and multiple off-ramps. And what my goal as an educator is to ensure that my students are able to do one of three things: go into a four-year degree program, go into a two-year degree program, or three, go straight into the workforce, right? Not every student is going to go to college. Not every student's going to go to a two-year program, but every student's going to go right into the workforce, right? I always tell my educators, your job is not to get your students to graduate high school. Your job is not to get your students to pass that science test. Your job is not to get them to write that research report. Your job as educators is to get your students employable. And if you focus on that, guess what? They're going to graduate high school. They're going to pass that science test, and they're going to write that research report. Our focus on employability enables our students to have opportunities. And that's what it's all about. And that's what specifically in cybersecurity, that this workforce gap is so huge. This workforce gap is going to only grow. So we have to ensure that we're funneling students into that workforce as fast as we can.
And Kevin, I think one of the great things about the exploration cards and that feature that you have on your website is that they do explain, like they tell you a little bit about the salary range and the educational pathways that are necessary for those careers. And quite a few of them are either technical school or directly into the workforce, right?
Absolutely. Those career profile cards really showcase the degrees or the careers that are available straight out of high school that you don't need a two-year, four-year degree in. And let me tell you, some of those numbers are astonishing, right? I'm in education. I'm like scratching my head going, wait a minute, I can go over here. But think about where some of these students are coming from. And many of us have to ask the question, how do we break a poverty cycle? How do we go into a rural community and ensure that these students who are very, very sharp have an opportunity to go in and make a career that, you know, if it was a $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 career, that was more than my parents were making combined growing up. And those are game changers. And so ensuring that we are focusing on those underserved communities, focusing on those Title I schools, focusing on those rural communities, that's where we begin to see a huge difference in impact in not only the workforce, but in the lives of young men and young women.
I was trying to remember my sign language, I think, when you were saying that about the rethinking careers. I think this is me too. Yeah. I think that I was thinking, yeah, me too. I was thinking about changing my career field. Samina, yeah. Would you have anything to add?
I think that Kevin really did sum it up very well. I think naturally working in the government, so far as an intern even, I've experienced meeting so many people from various paths of education and even getting into the workforce. I remember that there are individuals that are necessarily going into two-year degrees or four-year degrees, knowing what they want to get out of it. But there's also individuals who have certifications and certain internships that they take on post high school graduation that later turn into a career. So as Kevin mentioned, there are so many different pathways to take. And it's interesting because actually at Cyber Week this year, what we're focusing on is trying to find new ways to define what being an employable or career-oriented student means. And I think a lot of that even comes from some of the organizations that we're going to be working with. I know, for example, Amazon Web Services, who we've also been in contact with throughout the years, is interested in telling our groups of students who come through with Cyber Week programs a little bit more about how there's certain certifications and training programs that they can take on early in their, you know, post-high school years and continue to create a career later on. And if they'd like to pursue an education or if there's something in between that they would like to do to really solidify their career in cyber or whatever technology they might be doing, there is a way to do that. So it's really about defining it and kind of getting an idea of what students want to do and how we can support underserved communities, underrepresented communities to the fullest extent.
Yeah, I like that defining it. And part of that is that exposing students to these lessons and explaining what cybersecurity is. And so it just remind me, so how much is the curriculums that you both offer with Cyber Week program and the cyber.org? Go ahead, Samina. Go ahead.
Sorry. No, so actually cyberweek.org and all its resources are completely free to all students, teachers, and educators that want to take part. We basically provide all of the resources, whether that be the webinar platform, the curriculum, the guest speakers, and even sometimes some fun swag items at the end of the program to all participants and educators for free.
Amazing. And cyber.org has a bunch of curriculums for teachers. How much are those?
Yeah, absolutely free. We have free curriculum, free professional development, and free resources all over our website. And again, we're funded through a federal grant. That's how we were able to do this. You know, and everybody always says, "Oh, there's nothing in this world is free." And I always kind of joke and say, you're right. Nothing in this world is free, but you pay your taxes, so you're able to get these resources to you at no cost.
Finding those ways to reap the benefits, right? So there's a couple different words, and for those of us that are still learning about cybersecurity, what is the difference between cybersecurity and digital citizenship? Maybe Kevin, maybe you could start.
Yeah, so they're definitely intertwined, right? Cybersecurity to me is the holistic picture, kind of the big picture. And what we have to focus on is how do we dissect cybersecurity? Because many people think, oh my gosh, cybersecurity, that means I have to go hack something, or you know, I have to go do something on the offensive or on the defensive. And you know, to the individual who asked the question earlier, how in the world do we do cybersecurity at the younger age? We start with this idea of digital citizenship, this idea of ethics and cyber hygiene. You know, we have to teach our students how to operate and function on in cyberspace, right? And, you know, as a parent, would you go tell your kid, yeah, you can go down the dark alley in downtown at 11 o'clock at night? Absolutely no. So what we have to do as educators, what we have to do as counselors, what we have to do as parents is ensure that we are providing a safe space for our students to function online in cyberspace, and ensuring that we're not sharing passwords. How secure is your password? How can you create a good digital footprint in on the internet? And these are all topics that we're covering at that elementary level. So in order for us to have a cyber literate workforce, we have to start with the foundations, which in my opinion, digital citizenship and things of that nature.
Yeah, thank you, Kevin. Samina, would you have anything that you would want to add?
Oh, for sure. I think that especially when we think about cybersecurity as a whole, we have to recognize that the field is very diverse. So there are many different facets that students will choose to go into, and they are legitimately some of the greatest citizens, consumers, and creators when it comes to cybersecurity. So at Cyber Week, a lot of the times we like to introduce students to the varying levels of being a citizen and a digital citizen, and how media literacy and cyber literacy is so important to their journey. So I think that there's a lot of things that they will encounter early on. Having worked with elementary school students, I saw them using technology for the first time and understanding the threats that could be coming at them. And even at the high school and, you know, college level, they're going to be encountering certain things as they're applying to colleges, as they're thinking about how they're going to construct their futures. They really want to see the ways that cybersecurity can be a part of that, whether that be them becoming a cybersecurity lawyer or a public affairs person or a computer scientist. There's really a lot of ways that being a digital citizen is going to shape their journey.
Thank you. Okay, so as someone that is kind of still learning my, you said digital literacy, I hear words like hacking and ransomware, but then I hear hackathons. What's the difference? And why would I do one, or why would I bring it to my school?
Yeah, so hackathons are just our gamification of concepts that we're trying to instill in students, right? We want to show students how hacking works. We want to show students how these concepts work, but we want to do it in a safe environment, right? We don't want to turn a student loose on their, you know, school's network and say, go on ahead. You know, any IT director would lose their minds over that. So these hackathons are just great sandbox environments for students to be introduced to these kinds of concepts that we're trying to show. To protect it, we have to understand it. And that's the ultimate, mantra for not only DHS, where we're trying to secure it, defend it, and that way, and raise the awareness for the importance of cybersecurity.
Thank you. Samina, do you have anything to add? Have you ever participated in one of these?
Right. Actually, I am familiar with a lot of different hackathons that happen around the DC area, and a lot of them that are for students genuinely focus on a topic at hand. So a lot of the times it could be cybersecurity oriented or various, you know, entrepreneurial or computer science, you mesh together in some sort of topic for students to take part in. And I think it's a great way to not only be introduced to the field and understand maybe the tidbits of what it's like being a straight up computer scientist or related to being a cybersecurity professional, I think that it also allows you to meet a lot of different people that are in the field and get the opportunity to work with them and talk to them and maybe even see the diverse fields that they come from. So it's really a great experience that I'd highly recommend.
Let me ask some questions directly to each of you. Kevin, could you tell me a little bit about your journey and kind of what got you into cybersecurity and what you're doing with cyber.org?
Yeah, so I am not a cybersecurity guy. So my background is business and education. I started off into the school system and did all kinds of jobs, from in the classroom to director of marketing and development, and ended my K-12 experience as an educator as an assistant principal of a K-8 school. I call myself a recovering educator. While I'm not in the classroom now, I'm leaning upon that experience, and I've been with cyber.org for going on 7 years now, and have taken this program from 120 teachers to 22,000 teachers from across the country in all 50 states. I am passionate about this. I am passionate about helping educators because I remember being in those teacher's shoes. I remember being in those administrator's shoes. I remember being in those counselor's shoes. So being able to provide that understanding and these resources to you all is my top priority and my top passion.
Thank you, Kevin. Thanks. Samina, tell us a little bit about, as your second year in your four-year college, what are some of your next steps? What are some of your goals?
Sure. So even hearing about Kevin's story is so inspirational, because Cyber Week only just started about 2 years ago. Funny enough, it feels like it's been forever, but it's been 2 years. And it's interesting to see how different individuals, like Kevin, for example, was a teacher, and slowly he transitioned to understanding the marketing tactics and the educational specialists that can be out there to create such organizations. So in my future, I would definitely love to continue working within the media and media literacy with cyber to hopefully expand cyberweek.org each year that goes on, and also to be able to find different ways to use my position, hopefully a position that works within the media field of the government, focusing on different offices of science and technology policy, to be able to have that leg up to influence the policy that comes into the classrooms, but provide diverse perspectives when it comes to decisions that are being made in the government. I think that there are a lot of voices out there, a lot of teachers specifically, and counselors that want to have specific things that in their classrooms and in their schools to be able to provide their students, whether that be funding or just the time and place to even host programs like cyber.org or cyberweek.org. So I think having that perspective and being a part of NCWIT would make me an interesting voice in that community to be able to do so.
Thank you so much, Samina, and good luck with all of your goals and even just through the rest of this this semester. And thank you both of you for joining us today. Thank you for your presentation. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Thank you all for hosting, and thanks for the great questions from the audience.
Yes, thank you for a great event. It was really such a fun time.
Great. And attendees, we'd like to invite you next month to our webinar on May 19th about accessibility and computer science. And these sessions will feature a student panel as we strive for that computer science for all, making sure that it's accessible for all students. You can continue to receive updates from NCWIT C4C by filling out the link in the chat. And as we close out this webinar, a survey will pop up. We thank you for your responses and for joining us today, and we hope to see you next month. Bye.